Hello guys, welcome back. We're here again. Game number two. Team Alternate up against virtus.pro. Game number one was a bit of a whitewash. virtus.pro just, they walked away with it, honestly, after about 15 minutes. It was all the G show, but let's head into the game, shall we? Let's head into game number two. See what we've got on our hands. Because Darkseid, Quap banned out, Wisp and Doom taken by virtus.pro. So this does leave a few juicy heroes in the pool, but I'm not too sure where we're going to be heading, but I can welcome in my co-caster, Skim. What do you expect from Team Alternate in this one?
I feel like they should try to do something different, maybe, because Team Alternate, whenever we've seen them, they always go for the same kind of stuff. Oh, we have the Shadow Fiend, we have the Tusk, you know, these kind of like standard heroes. I mean, yeah, sure, it works for them here and there, but maybe try something different, especially with virtus.pro. I mean, there was some wacky draft, right? Maybe try to throw curveball here and there.
Oh, that I think that draft is like one in a million. I hope it is anyway. But they start off with their patented Shadow Fiend. Let's see what we actually get back from VP. Let's see, Alchemist, and is it going to be the Venomancer? Yep, there we go. The same heroes as last time. And no, oh my goodness. My question is, do we see the exact same draft as we did in game number one? I said it's one in a million. I am now starting to regret my words because I've got a feeling virtus.pro just go for the exact same lineup they had before.
I mean, I doubt we're going to see a Broodmother being led through. I think if you're Team Alternate, you definitely ban a Brood just in case. But it's definitely in a very similar notion. I mean, the Alchemist and Venomancer are sort of like, I mean, it is just this, a really good opener if you think about it. Just because it is really flexible, Alchemist can be mid, can be carry, can be support. The same for Venomancer, can be support, offlane, mid. So if you're virtus.pro and you feel comfortable running both heroes in all these positions as well, then it's probably the best opener that you can have. And for Team Alternate, it's more like, well, let's cover all our bases and maybe pick something that is good against sort of like all combinations. And I think in that regard, the Ancient Apparition is actually still a really good pick.
Yeah, go with the AA again. And the trouble is that there are good heroes out there. Like VP banned Clockwork in the second phase. And I don't know if Team Alternate can really get away with not taking a Clockwork now. I go with the Winter Wyvern, though. I'm a big fan of their Invoker play, but I don't think we're going to see it this game. Just the fact that you've got Shadow Fiend, Wyvern, both heroes that, you know, they take up a lot of the jungle, they take a lot of time to farm up, and you need some setup for that Invoker. You need some really good short cooldown, lockdown, and stuns, and people that can control the team fights for him, because he does a ton of damage, he can offer you a bit of utility here and there, but against Alchemist and Venomancer, he can get kited, he can get taken down, and you get forced into something like a BKB too early on. It really does get rough, but Alternate, ban out the Broodmother, like you said, they're going to go down that road. While VP, these bans we've seen before. Wisp, Doom, Ember, and you know what? I think they're going to ban the Clockwork again in their fourth ban.
I think it makes sense, to be honest. Clockwork is just a really good hero. If you do want to run, for example, the Venomancer as a core, which I think is very likely, the Clockwork is actually really good in just isolating the Venomancer. Because what you want to do as Venomancer, you want to be in a team fight. You want to just be in the midst of everything, right? And, you know what, they're just like, yeah, we don't even need to ban it, we can just pick it ourselves.
Yeah, if you're going to ban the Broodmother, we need something for DK Phobos up at top, so Clockwork. Up against Shadow Fiend, up against Winter Wyvern, it's not too bad, you know, you hook in. Yeah, do exactly what you're saying, you isolate them, make sure that they can't get their big nukes and AoE ultimates out, and you can actually get Venomancer in there with the Plague Wards and the Venomous Gale. So Clockwork going to be their starter, and they've got lots of follow-up to actually bring to the table as well. But virtus.pro, you mentioned that Veno, Alchemist, both very versatile heroes, can go into multiple lanes. We have no idea what they're doing just yet. So this is why it's so difficult for Team Alternate to actually draft themselves through this. They've got to concentrate on lanes, on their game plan, because I don't think that in this scenario you can really look at the enemy draft and think, right, we'll counter that, we'll counter that, we'll deal with this way. Because you don't know what's going to be actually hitting you, whether it be the first 5 minutes, the middle 10 minutes, when they're taking Roshan, when they're doing anything.
Yeah, and I just want to point out that Team Alternate respect banned the TA from G. Broodmother, I can see definitely happening. It's not necessarily just because of the player, but more because it's just really annoying to play against. But TA is definitely a respect ban, where you're like, yeah, we're not giving G TA again, just because he was so disgustingly good in that hero. He not only destroyed the SF in the lane, but also, after being ganked twice or three times even, he recovered and just destroyed all of Team Alternate. So this is a really good respect ban, and I like this Windrunner or Windranger pickup here from virtus.pro just because it is also one of those heroes that goes toe-to-toe with the Shadow Fiend.
Wow. Alternate Bane. Pretty decent against the Alchemist. Lock him down so he can't get his ultimate off, but interesting. They've got good single target lockdown, some decent AoE team fight abilities, but they just feel like they're lacking that kind of synergy hero, right? There's no Darkseer, there's no Clockwork. They need that offlane hero that can do everything in between, because they've got point A and they've got point Z covered, but they need everything between to actually, you know, bring the team fights together and give them that little spark. And I don't know if something like an Earthshaker does it for them. He can do decently on the bottom lane, block off the creep wave and get himself some experience and a little bit of gold. But what offlane is there actually left out in the pool? And you mentioned aggro tri-lane in game number one. Well, Nightstalker. Is this the hero that's going to run around and actually control things for them?
Nightstalker is, I don't know, just assuming that either Alchemist or Venomancer is going to be in the safe lane as the carry, I feel like Nightstalker is not really going to accomplish much in the lane. And also just against the Windrunner, I feel like
5 seconds.
Or rather, in the sense that as if you run an offlane Nightstalker, you just want to rotate to the mid lane at some point, right? Because minute four, it's going to be dark. You want to rotate to the mid lane. I'm not sure if Windrunner is really such a good hero to gank with as a Nightstalker, just because it's really awkward ganking from the Dire offlane to the Radiant mid. I feel, sure, you have that jungle sort of aspect, but you're just gonna have to kind of run past the two supports. So I'm not sure about this. I'm really not sold on the Nightstalker here. And I do agree with what you said earlier. There's not really the team cohesion that you kind of want to sort of like Wombo combo or at least like sort of like ganking squad. There's no really synergy in this lineup so far from Team Alternate.
Yeah, and virtus.pro, they've been very good with their wards so far in game number one. Alchemist, I'm guessing, is going to be doing a similar job as he did last time, just running around or no? Where's... See, again, I think Venomancer is going to be the one role again. Alchemist support with the AA, and they control things a little bit there. But if they ward up, you know, one Observer ward can ruin a Nightstalker, can't it? So I think it's going to be very important for Team Alternate to get sentries to the Nightstalker, de-ward where they can, and limit VP's vision, especially going into that first nighttime, like you said, because it's vital that they actually gank into this Windranger. And you look at VP, they don't have the best heroes to react and TP to save the Windranger. So if you've got Bane, Wyvern, Nightstalker, SF, if those four heroes can converge onto the middle lane, they've got the damage, they've got the stuns and slows to actually kill her before anything can happen. And with the Wraith King, oh boy, I see tons of fighting early on. I think Alternate going for another brawling lineup here. Nothing too surprising in terms of lanes. I think they're just going to go stock standard. Maybe you put like the Wyvern or the Bane with the Nightstalker initially and put them down there to try and control things a little bit more in the offlane and, you know, get the wards and the D wards out. But Radiant, what have we got? FNG support Alchemist again. Yep, Illidan, one roll Venomancer, G on the Windranger, Lil, Ancient Apparition. And DK Phobos heading up to the Clockwork offlane, while over in the Dire, Supreme, Wraith King 1. Lissash on the Bane, Nisha playing the Winter Wyvern, all heading up to top lane actually, while Exotic Deer, your SF mid, and Sasu, Nightstalker down and bot, only one Mango, and not the 3, 4, 5, 6 Mango strat we've seen from Darkseers, from Nightstalkers in the past. But let's take a look. He's got one Observer Ward, no sentries on him. Well, Lil has Obs and Sentries. FNG got himself a Sentry, and Clockwork already gets his Observer Ward down, so he's going to see everything that happens over on this top lane.
Just to come back to the draft a little bit, I'm not sure about this two melee cores into Clockwork, to be honest. Especially just because of the Wraith King. You want a mobility item, sure, but just, I don't know. I'm not really sold on this, and I think just in team fights, when it gets really messy, Clockwork is just so good against both Nightstalker and Wraith King. So, and also you have a little bit of mana burn, right, with a cog. So this is something that Supreme has to be really careful of, and he's going to be forced into a very early mobility item, I feel.
Well, up at top, securing the rune for the Shadow Fiend, but it's going to be the one-for-one trade-off that we see the majority of the games. No contest whatsoever. Nightstalker. Ooh, did his ward get actually counted out there? Yeah, Venomancer has one last hit, so already taken it out. And this is the big thing. Like, Nightstalker now has no vision, doesn't know where the supports are. It can't really move towards middle lane that easily. And you look at this Observer Ward here. the one that the Radiant have, actually watching for his rotations, it's going to be perfect, because they know when he's heading to rune, and when he goes, you know, missing off in this area, they know exactly where he's heading and when he'll hit mid. FNG acid sprays out, and Bane can't get in there to do too much damage to G, so it is the 1v1 vacuum matchup, SF against Windranger. The two supports are, like, battling out between each other. Nisha, yeah, gets the D ward here against the Clockwork. Also, nice little sentry there.
Oh, G has to be really careful. He's going to be body blocked, and there's one brain sap, and he's dead.
Oh, wow. Oh, creep wave working against him.
Yeah, that was... I don't know. I think it was really, just really well played from Lisa. Or Lisa. I don't think G necessarily misplayed that, but he should have been more aware of that. He tried to be really cocky, trading sort of like harassment with ESF and just trying to creep aggro, but... Yeah, he should have been more aware of the fact that the Bane was there, just because, as you said, FNG was battling up against him.
Well, Lil is very high up in his lane, so Sasu, what are we sitting at? Level 1? Level 1. Can't get any experience, really, while Clockwork is having a better time up at top. Supreme, with Nisha here, they could actually look for a kill onto Phobos. Oh, Arctic Burn's on cooldown, so they can't really go for that. And Phobos will realize this, trade a few hits here with the Winter Wyvern, get some damage down onto her. But this is the thing as a Clockwork, with the Bane now rotating up, you're going to have a pretty rough time, but it's three heroes once again. Alternate have to put three heroes to deal with the Clockwork. G has the 1v1 against the Shadow Fiend, which he's died once, but look at him! He's outlast sitting now. He's going to take control of this game, take control of the lane, and Exotic Deer with no bottle just yet, G is going to have it a little bit faster.
Illusion. Yeah, I like what G is doing. He like realized that Exotic Deer has no mana anymore, or... little to no mana anymore, so he forces Exotic Deer to last it under the tower, which he can't really do too much without having raises. So it's really good, just good awareness from G and just really well played.
Well, FNG, where are you heading off to? He's got stun and acid spray, but the Bane has been scouted. Clockwork walks over and says hello. So G is playing a little more defensively now. He realizes that, you know, Brain Sap, a Nightmare, a couple of raises, and he will go down. But just look at that. The fact that Bane's Brain Sap got reduced in mana cost, it's so effective now in trading last hit, in trading hits anyway. Because before it was like, right, I can cast Brain Sap twice, and then have to wait to regen, have to clarity up. Now you can cast it like three or four times, and it's perfectly fine. Sasu. He's got his Stout Shield procking away. He's okay, but...
still level one, though.
Yeah, exactly. I say he's okay. He's not under threat of death. But he's not getting any experience either. This Observer Ward has crushed him, honestly. The fact he has no vision, doesn't know when AA is pulling or harassing, or doesn't know where FNG is. FNG, without his Grievous Greed, not going to be able to get the full value out of any bounty runes or anything. But every lane, once again, won by VP, it feels like. Top, maybe this is going to change. Supreme, going to get the stun down onto Phobos, and okay, they're going to get the kill here onto that Clockwork, so 2-0. But these kills... it's a nice little bit of gold. What does it give you in the long run? Does it put your Wraith King any closer to a big item? No, not really. And I think this is one of the big things. Wraith King itemization. It's very difficult, honestly, to actually decide what to go for. One of the standard builds is, you know, treads, blademail, drums, blink dagger into like a radiance or something. That's like the pub carry build. We've seen armlets, we've seen Midases. But in this game, what do you really want to see from him?
I definitely think he needs a blink dagger, just to be able to sort of like initiate and make space for the SF and possibly even rotate early on, sort of like early on, just to make sure that his team takes a bit of advantage of the aggressive nature that they have. I mean, you have a Nightstalk, you have a Bane, you kind of want to be aggressive early on, right? So I think he definitely want a blink dagger as early as possible, but if his farm is not going too well, you might just see him just go straight for the blade mail. It's a really good item to have against a Venomancer and against an AA, even against a Windrunner, so... oh, mid lane. Exotic Deer will be stunned up, but nah.
I'm not going to find it. TP comes in, and this is one of the great things. I talked about
G
how...
G has to be careful here.
Hey, you're right. In comes Liz Sash. They've got that Splinter Blast, and G takes a raise to the face. The secondary one body blocks it here, and the right clicks will come out. They do come in to try and take a counter kill, but Exotic Deer is going to get the hits in onto FNG. Double kill for Nisha, and Lil TP's in, and this is what I was saying. Reaction from VP just isn't available. They don't have heroes like Dazzle who can come in and grave and heal. They don't have heroes who can come in and instantly stun. Whereas Team Alternate, they can TP in one hero, they can run Nightstalker across in this first nighttime, and everything is pretty seamless with that movement across. So they've got themselves a good couple of kills. Venomancer still farming away on bottom lane, he's gone for the treads this time. So no arcanes into mech for him, or that's what it appears. Up at top, DK Phobos is going to die as well. So 0-5 virtus.pro, they're getting a little bit handled. Like, I thought it was okay for the first couple of minutes, but if they keep giving kills away, Team Alternate could run away with it.
And it's all just because of this Bane. Look at him. 2 kills, 3 assists. So it means he was part of all 5 kills that this team currently has. He's just, his rotations were just on point. He made sure to kill the Windrunner twice. So I don't know. This Bane is basically setting up the early game for his team. This is as much as he can ask from support, to be honest. And this is where I'm not sure about the support Alchemist. I mean, we saw it last game, and I thought last game it just worked, paid off. Oh, FNG.
Yeah, he's gonna go in for the stun, but DD rune. FNG gets it. And it looks like there's not gonna be a trade-off of kills or anything along those lines. But yeah, what are you saying?
But yeah, I thought the last game it only worked out just because of the synergy with the TA, right? You have the minus armor from the acid spray, which is really nice. And you can help excel the TA's farm. Whereas in this game, you can't really stack ancients and let the Windrunner take the ancients just because she can't really do it, right? So I'm not sure about this Alchemist in this game. And as you can see, FNG only level 3. He hasn't stacked a single camp. He hasn't really accomplished much either. In fact, he only just died once. That's pretty much his whole accomplishment in this game.
Well, Illidan, what's he going to be going for, do you reckon? There's no Midas in the works. Do you go Treads into Blink? Do you go Rush Aghanim Scepter? You know, Aghanim's Blink Octarine Core is my favorite build on a Venno, but I don't know what you do with a Venomancer in this game.
It's interesting to see that they have such a different approach in this game. Last game, he went straight for the mech, or after the Arcane Boots, straight for the mech. And I honestly thought this game, he should just do the same stuff, right? You just go Arcane Boots, mech. This game, I don't know. I still think that mech is viable. Maybe just with the Dreads instead.
Possibly. Possibly. We'll see where he heads to, but I'm not entirely sure. Now, FNG is going to go for the same old Medallion Solar Crest, I'm guessing here. He's got his level 3. Exotic Tier going to clear through some creep camps, though. And this is where Shadow Fiend really starts to shine. Gets himself up to, you know, 3k plus in the net worth. He's had a little bit of a rough time at middle lane again. Exotic Tier getting a little bit outplayed by G, but he'll be able to clear out these camps. Get himself a good amount of gold. And taking a look down at bot lane, I've got a nice little observer ward there from Nisha, watching out. But where's the Nightstalker? He's level 3 and they've given him mid again. So this is something that Team Alternate have been, you know, very, very good at consistently, is giving supports or offlaners a little bit of time towards the middle lane. And usually it's because, you know, Shadow Fiend is farming jungle. They've got an Ember Spirit or something that likes to, you know, move around a little bit in this period of time. But it's daytime now, so Sasu doesn't have that guise of nighttime to run himself around and look for these openings. And Lissash, 2-0-3, like you were saying on this Bane, great start. He's still got to deal with his Clockwork, though, who's nearly level 6. And once this hookshot's up, they do have a TP reaction hero that can actually roam around and really counteract the aggressive plays of Team Alternate.
Yeah. I'm not sure about that. I said it earlier on, I'm not too sure about this Nightstalker. But I feel like if Alternate can sort of, like, hang in there throughout the whole mid-game, I guess that's really when the Nightstalker pays off. Once you have, like, an Aghanim Scepter, you get control of the map, right? You want to restrict the farm on the Venomancer and the Windranger, but just, you know, keeping control of the map. So I guess that's sort of like when it's going to pay off. But I feel like Sasu's going to be a bit of like dead weight for the next 3 to 4 minutes until at least it's going to be next nighttime again.
Supreme. Threads into Blink, it looks like. Still not taking this tier 1 up on top, though, even with the pressure they've been applying, while FNG, speaking about how good Alternate have been doing, or how well they've been doing, giving their supports a little bit of free time to farm, Illidan makes a move into the jungle. So he's given FNG's Alchemist time to get level 6, and potentially even his Medallion now. Actually going to be not too far away. But, oh, look at that Lil. The knowledge, the awareness, Sentry Ward goes straight down on top of the Obs. Pretty much instantly counted out, you know, that lasted a minute at most from Nisha.
Speaking of which, though, his own observer ward is not going to last much longer either.
Counted.
Oh, he denies it at least. You don't want to give 50 gold away to the support.
Well, Supreme, I'm going to try and push into this tier 1. It looks like, yeah, DK Phobos is run out of HP. He can't jump in here unless they have a little bit of help from, I don't know, an AA Ice Blast once he hits level 6. But Ancient Apparition, Lil, not getting a great start. You know, in the previous game, we saw 8 minutes in, the supports were seeing a level 6, getting themselves a nice amount of farm, and they're going to rotate into bottom lane. Lissash actually smokes himself up. Fiend's Grip is available. But who do they go for? FNG is very low on the old HP, and that's who they're going to go for, straight in onto the Alchemist. Quick and easy kill. As FNG buys up his medallion over back at home.
That timing, actually. Lil actually just popped a smoke. I'm not sure if it was like a panic smoke or if he actually just wanted to smoke himself, but they definitely caught them off guard. So that was really good. Nice rotation. Fiendscript use. Yeah, sure, you only get like a support alchemist, but it's a kill regardless, right? So that's pretty good for them. And I don't know, Illidan. He's going for a Veil of Discord, it looks like.
Okay. That seems reasonable. If they're going to be met with fighting very early on, which you just know you are, being able to get that Veil plus ulti out... Oh, misses the Gale onto Supreme. They do have the Clockwork with the Hookshot ready, looking to get in here, but... they're still going to go for this. Ice Blast off the mark, basically missing everything. Basically missing everything, as the Shadow Fiend just farming through the jungle. Exotic Deer gets himself up to Treads and his Ring of Aquila. I don't know if you even go mech in this game, just because of that AA.
Yeah, I agree. You don't really want to, like, mech in itself is already on a support, or not on a support, but just in general, is not as valuable as it used to be. Aw, poor FNG. He just wants to farm.
Well, Winter's Curse will secure that one, it looks like. And Lissash, actually, his Fiend's Grip is coming off cooldown. Middle lane, Phobos finds the kill on that Stalker, but Exotic Deer should be able to find a counter here with one raise. Oh, he doesn't even need the raise. Holds onto it and right-clicks him down. And with his Ogre Club, tanks through the Battery Assault. Up at top, Illidan. Okay, they've switched things up here. The army of Plague Ward's going to be harassing zoning and pushing this lane out pretty heavily as Supreme. He hasn't bought Blink. He has saved up 3,000 gold. And I'm starting to wonder if this is a Radiance rush.
Is this a Radiance? Please, let it be a Radiance.
I honestly think it's like one of the best items up against, on this Wraith King.
Okay, can you look at top FNG? He's actually not seeing this Observer Ward.
No.
I mean, it's gonna run out anyway, but still, that's like, what? How do you not see it?
No idea. It's invisible. It's absolutely invisible. G gets caught amid, though. He gets killed on Shadow Fiend, but TP completes. And the Bane doesn't get there in time.
I didn't watch, but there's no way that SF should be solo killed by a Windrunner or a Windranger with these items. That was definitely a misplay from Exotic Deer.
I think he was still running low on HP from when he went to kill the Clockwork.
Yeah, probably.
Just sort of, you know, hung around a Power Shot, a Shackle, a Focus Fire, and that'll do it for you. FNG waiting it out, looking for Nisha. They know he's up there, but not exactly where. Well, come in and clear out this tower.
Oh, the rotation. Sasu.
Oh, FNG gets his ultimate off, so the heal is there, but does he have enough to tank through it all? The stun? FNG, they can't kill him. Lissash turns back. He doesn't want to get involved. Hook shot into the neutral creeps. And that's going to be a rough one for Phobos. He's still committing for this, though. Supreme has his ultimate. There's no way you get away with this team fight. Illidan gets cursed up, and he's going to get held in place. FNG, shackle shot from the back here. Lissash comes in, and Lil gets the kill there onto him as Illidan dies on the back lines. And Supreme still has that reincarnation. Ice Blast flies across, we'll catch a couple of them, but FNG dies and the retreat is there. As virtus.pro, get the hell out of dodge. That was really awkward though from virtus.pro.
Yeah, it looked like halfway through they didn't want to engage, but then the hookshot came in, and then it really, again, looked like they didn't want to engage just because FNG was actually trying to retreat, but it looked like the give up was, nah guys, I got this. And then it just died. So yeah, this is the kind of stuff that VP cannot happen to them, just because if these, like, this is so favoring ATN's lineup, right? They don't really peak right now, they peak a bit later on in like 10 to 15 minutes.
Yeah.
And this just accelerates their farm. They want to kill these people here.
Supreme, is there a stun? Is there something to stop you from TPing? No, there's not. Exotic Deer, though, there we go. Hookshot in, and he'll drop. Pretty simple takedown. There's your combo. Ice Blast, Venomous Gale, and Illidan gets in there with a nice kill, helped out by DK Phobos, but I'm looking at this Wraith King, and I'm seeing a Relic. There we go. Relic's up, so Radiance is the build. I've honestly not seen this before. Now, I've seen Treads Drums, Radiance, Treads Drums, Blademail Radiance. I've always seen Radiance as like a third, fourth item, just to sort of bolster your tankiness and get you into the middle. But isn't this the Slasher's way? He released a new video recently where it was like,
oh, yeah.
Radiant's attack. Refresher.
Dire's top tower is this? I mean, I think Radiant's is legit. I'm not sure about Refresher, though.
I mean, yeah, you refresh your ultimate. You go in with three lives instead of two. Three is better than two. I don't think he'll go for Refresher, but this is a deviation from like the regular kind of pub stomping build and going straight into your Radiance. Obviously, it's a great farming item as well. You can go and clear down creep waves, you can push into towers, and it makes it difficult for virtus.pro to actually stand and fight up against you. So the Wraith King can get up into the thick of things, while the Wyvern, Shadowfiend, Bane, and the Nightstalker can kind of, you know, juke, jive, dance a little bit, and play a little bit back off the Wraith King. Well, they can also farm themselves up as well. Now, Dire Observer Ward spots out the Shadow Fiend farming up here. Do they have someone who can jump in on him, though? Phobos? Hookshot?
Doesn't yeah, but there's no real follow-up. If anything, they would have to start out the AA ult early. I'm not even sure that AA ult Phobos will be enough to take down the SF at this point. He's pretty tanky. He has a Sanj, so... Eh, it's not worth it, probably. I do want to point out, though, that G, he's 1k ahead of that Shadow Fiend. Even though he died, like, twice in lane, and SF had, like, stacks prepared for him, so, gee, I don't know how he does it, but he's top of the net worth chart.
Ridiculous stuff. Now, Phobos has been caught by the Fiend's Grip, and I'll come back to my point in a second, but can they kill him? Can they finish him off? They get the hook shot down, and the Battery Sword. Lissash not gonna be able to heal himself up. Ice Blast should tick him over, and with the Power Shot, definitely will. I don't have a way to catch up here to Sasu. Maybe they can get Nisha, though. No, not gonna commit for that one. But in these team fights, it's situations like this where if they get a good hook shot, a good ice blast, and they've got all of these abilities that can kill off, you know, two heroes before the fight really begins, if they can actually break the line of Team Ultimate, ignore the Wraith King, I think that's the plan here. You ignore the Wraith King, sure, he's got Radiance, so what? You can do all you want pushing into towers and running through us. If they can get past him and into your Shadow Fiend, into your Bane, your Winter Wyvern, and find these kills before the fight really starts, that's where things look bad for Ultimate, right? Their laning phase has gone well, they've got items that they need, but if that one big burst hit comes in with a Poison Nova and a Venomous Gale onto multiple people, VP, get the numbers advantage, and that's when Wraith King starts to look a little bit weak.
Oh, bottom lane. They tried to go for a Q play. It was a very, very optimistic shackle from G.
It was a tight angle.
Yeah. But Lil believed. Lil believed. He immediately shot out the AA blast. He was not even hesitating. He was like, yeah, bro, I trust in you.
Well, I tried it. Did not succeed this time. Nisha has a Glimmer Cape, so I went to Wyvern. He has that Glimmer up, and the Bane, even with his great start, doesn't have an amazing amount of items. So they've prioritized farm a little bit more on the Winter Wyvern while the Bane buys all the obs, buys all the sentries and things like that. I guess Nisha's 4-0-3 as well, like, honestly.
If you're support, that's like the ultimate sort of like, hey guys, please, I won you guys the early game. Why don't you let me farm? And instead, like, Nisha, the guy that was sort of like on lane and babysitting, he's like, oh yeah, sure, I got Glimmer Cape.
I've got my item. Well, this is where the Winter Wyvern really wants to be, and you don't need to go any further forward than this. You know, Glimmer Cape is like the item for the Winter Wyvern. Blink is good, Refresher is good, but none of them really necessary. Cold Embrace with that Glimmer Cape, perfect defensive capabilities for him. Now, G, Aghanim's up. I'm guessing Blink next, just to do what I was saying before and break the lines, get behind the Wraith King. And then you go into your damage item after. Go into the crit, something like that. So save up for your blink, get into the mobility. Meanwhile, mid. DK Phobos. Nightmared and gripped. The reaction is not here from VP just yet. He gets the stick charges off, but he'll finish. Burn that Arctic Burn. I don't have anyone to turn back around. And this is the problem. If Clockwork is playing aggressively and forward like that, there's still no one that can come in and help, right? He is the hero that saves the day. He's the hero that initiates. He's the hero that counter-initiates. Everyone else is just there bolstering the team fight of virtus.pro.
Yeah, and this is something that ATN just kind of has to bank on, these sort of, like, pickoffs, because, as you said, there's no really... Except for the Clockwork, there's no real follow-up, just because there's no mobility item yet. And as I say that, G picks up the Blink. So, yeah, but still... You definitely want to go for pickoffs. You don't really want to take head-on team fights just because you don't want to give Illidan the opportunity to hit like a really good Nova. So this is really good for alternate. It didn't really extend too much, and Supreme, he's just free farming the whole time. He's just P. PvE all day.
Yeah. Now, last game we didn't see the Alchemist buying any Aghanim Scepters for his teammates, and obviously
actually he did.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he did. I'm not sure if he actually completed it, but he had like 3 parts ready.
Oh. Okay. Maybe this game we'll be able to see it, you know, come to fruition, because Clockwork Ags, great. AA Ags, amazing. Venomancer, guess what? Ags is freaking gorgeous on it. But Windranger's already bought one. Later on, you know, you can switch it out, sell your Ags, and get one given to you by the Alk, but there are 3 other heroes there that really come before that. Who do you see it going to first? Because Illidan can kind of farm his. I don't know if he's got the time or if he has the kind of inclination to farm it up himself, but AA is the one I'm looking at thinking that's going to be the best Ags you could possibly hope for, as FNG goes in for the stun, the hook shot, blocked out by Illidan, and Phobos, he's going to be fuming, absolutely fuming. Fort goes out of the tower. They don't get too much damage done to it. Meanwhile, middle lane, Supreme and Exotic Deer take down a tier 1 of their own. And yep, Radiance, Blade Mail, and I am going to put my money on Refresher Orb next.
I definitely want to see it. Somewhere in Sweden. Wait, is he from Sweden? No, he's from Denmark. Denmark, yeah. Somewhere in Denmark, Slash is just sitting in like...
rubbing his hands together, going, yeah. Hey, 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 hey. People are going to watch my videos and they're going to flip and build my builds. Oh, gee. He's been seen, but he blinks himself back and away. Is Liz Sash not going to get Nightmare or anything off?
Good ping coming out from FNG. He's like, guys, ward there. And let's see if the D ward is going to be picked. Oh, they don't even have a D ward. Never mind.
No, they don't. They don't. Supreme, though, honestly. What are you doing? Wraith King has always been a fighting carry. You jump in, you get your 2 lives, you jump out, and you shake it all about. But he hasn't really been doing too much. But the weird thing is, I kind of like this. Team Alternate, they've got a fighting lineup. You said 40 minutes in that their real peak doesn't come until, like, you know, 25, maybe 30. But they've given so... Like, Nightstalker has had so much time. He's hit level 11. He's nearly got his Aghanim Scepter. And this is a hero that I thought would struggle immensely.
Yeah.
But he's doing very well for himself. Top lane. Supreme gets himself away. The TP's coming to react.
Look at what's coming in. Rocket, AA ult, everything.
Yeah. Just throw stuff at him. See what happens. See what sticks. Bot lane. FNG is going to hide himself. But this is just dancing back and forth from both teams. No one really wants to get into a big brawl. Both of them are pretty content getting their items. If we look at this and say, okay, Venomancer, if you get a blink now, then you've got blink on Veno, Windranger, you've got Ice Blast, Clock Hookshot, Acid Spray. I feel like VP are favored for the next 5 minutes or so, like the next 2 to 3 big team fights. I think VP, as long as they get this, like, as long as they can cast their abilities and they don't get silenced or disrupted or, you know, killed off before they can, then they've got a good way to get into these team fights. Kill Wyvern, who has a mech, and take out that Bane before things go nasty. But if they leave it a little bit too long, Team Alternate start to get into the swing of things.
Exactly. The thing is, though, if you're Team Alternate, you just try to avoid these sort of like scenarios where VP can shine. You just don't want to take on any sort of like engagement that involves more than 3 heroes, right? You just do what you've been doing like the past 23 minutes. You just farm on Supreme and just hope that he's just going to carry everything. And as I said earlier, like, this Nightstalker should have never been allowed to farm up an Aghanim. He was struggling so hard, but VP is just not applying any pressure whatsoever. Like, they haven't even taken the tier 1 bottom. That's how little pressure they've applied. They haven't taken the offlane tier 1 yet.
Yeah. And the thing is, that was on a Venomancer lane.
Yeah, exactly.
And they've already
Venomancer
used, like,
usually takes these, like, really early on.
But they tried it, what, 5 minutes? Yeah, Glyph is back up. They popped Glyph down on the bottom tier 1 when Windranger went to Focus Fire, and they couldn't get it then. They will smoke up, though. It looks like virtus.pro, they want to try and force something. Exotic Deer, this is a relatively risky place to farm down on the low ground with no vision up in your own jungle.
Yeah, and I think he realizes this now, or at least this is just an awkward timing for VP, because he just finished farming.
Yeah, exactly. There's no creep camps left. I don't know if he realized, or he's just like, well, there's nothing left to farm. I'll go somewhere else where there is. He's throwing down a bot. It looks like they want the tier 1 here as well. Illidan, Veil, Blink, level 2 Poison Nova, but only 1 point in the Gale, so I have to see exactly.
Honestly, they can fight this. I think they can fight this. I mean, you have AA and Clock just across the map, but you can just always shoot stuff at him. So if they want, they could technically fight this. But ATN, they do it the smart way. They smoke up first and try to go for a kill first.
Rocket Flesh scouts at Roshan, but no one's in there. Now, G, You've got Chilling Touch, you've got your Blink, Shackle, Sasu's caught, but the reactive TPs, look at this! They're all here, the Blink forward and G is caught, this is it, alternate. They've got great heroes to come in and actually turn things back around. The Shackle shot in 3 seconds time, but G is silenced. They've got the chase. They're going to Blink Dagger up in a couple of seconds, and with that Wraithfire Blast, Hookshot comes in, the curse is turned back onto them, and G along with DK Phobos both taken out.
I guess at least they take a tier 1 now?
At least? Like, yeah. that's not a worthwhile trade. And I know I keep hammering on about it, but it honestly is the pivotal factor here. Alternate can both initiate and react. VP can only really initiate with their lineup. There's a bunch of heroes here where Alternate can say, right, we've got tanky-ass Nightstalker, Wraithkin, Shadowfiend now with his BKB nearly done. A bunch of heroes that can just hold their own for the couple of seconds it takes for Wyvern to TP in, counter-initiate, jump in, Bane. Fiend's Whip wasn't even used. So they can still go for another fight here. They can go and hunt, look for FNG, look for Illidan. But Virtus Pro, they're actually being held. Not just to a stalemate, but possibly to a loss here. Double mangoes over on the AA. I don't know what Lil is doing, but apparently he wants some juicy, juicy mangoes.
I think he's just preparing for the end screen, you know, where he only has mangoes in his inventory.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's what he's preparing for, because as you said, like, I don't want to call GG preemptively or something, but if you're a VP, you're just counting the minutes right now, because the time is definitely running out for them. This lineup has a clock on it.
Well, I jump in with the Poison Nova, but it looks like the hookshot misses. Lissash turns. Gets the Fiend's Grip down onto Illidan, and in jumps Supreme. Here we go. Illidan, he's pretty much dead. Raze will finish him off. Exotic Deer is going to get himself away here, but Lissash not going to be so lucky. Finished off by the Rocket Flare as Phobos is stuck. There's a stun. There we go. Supreme gets it, and a 2-for-1 trade-off. Bane Elemental, not exactly the hero you want to pick off. VP, they seem so desperate. Because not only do I feel that, like you said, they're just thinking, right, we've got limited time here, we need to go and fight. That's what's running through their minds. You know, they need to force it. Every time they've forced it, Alternate have been one step ahead. They've known exactly what's coming, and FNG, he's screwed. He is raw. Maybe not. Shackle Shot holds him out, and FNG cannot get his ultimate off because it's on cooldown. Supreme walks in with his level 3 ultimate. Radiance up, and a double kill for him. G on the retreat. Power Shot across. Not going to finish him off. So he's still got his reincarnation, but G. Time to blink, time to run. Baiting it out a little bit here. Where's he going? This nice talk ragging him sees all. He knows. Okay, he's dead. He cannot escape. That's a team wipe.
I'm not sure G realized that this isn't Aghanim's Nightstalker, because I'm not sure what he just tried to do there in the tree line.
Is Illidan dead as well?
I'm pretty sure he is.
They don't have Poison Nova. They don't have TPs to come in. There's a Clockwork walking his way over here with a hookshot, but he's like, God, you're already dead. I'm going to walk away. I am seriously worried here for VP.
I just hope that VP doesn't call GG until we see what item Supreme is going for next, to be honest.
Refresher Orb.
I really want to see it. No, but seriously, VP, they just missed their timing completely. This lineup was meant to be more like controlling early on. They definitely want to have map control with this lineup. With a Venomancer, you want to push towers early on or mid lane. The Phobos, nice hookshot.
Catch the Bane. Sasu's pushed back as well. FNG doesn't have ultimate, but they kill off the Bane, and Sasu doesn't want anything to do with this anymore. But yeah, I agree. They dewarded the Nightstalker so he couldn't roam towards mid, but G played so hyper-aggressively. Team Alternate this time around. They got their support towards middle lane, and G, I think you hit the nail on the head like 3 minutes in. Windranger cannot farm Ancients, cannot really flash farm these jungle camps. So even though he had good net worth, he couldn't create that gap which we, you know, expect from these mid laners. He couldn't go find solo pickoffs because Wraith King wasn't a lane that you can gank into. You couldn't go top and say, right, I'm going to go kill Wraith King. Nightstalker was super elusive. You couldn't go and gank into him. So middle lane was the only place G could stay against that Shadow Fiend. And then you had these two heroes behind him constantly, the Wyvern and the Bane. So it was almost impossible. Now, Wraith King is going for Mjolnir. And this is more of like the standard build, just with the kind of build order a little bit muddled up, where We used to see like Treads, Drums, Blade Mail, then Maelstrom, Radiance, Mjolnir with a Blink thrown in somewhere in the between. But Mjolnir basically means that he can go and stand up on high ground, buy a tier 3, gives him great attack speed, but also means that VP can't really just go and fight him, and Supreme knows this, so he walks into the middle. Illidan is slowed, stunned. And burnt down a little bit by the Radiance, but Supreme doesn't have the teammates behind him to actually follow through on it.
Again, how do you fight this? I think if you VP, you're just trusting that you can possibly... Oh my god, Illidan just misclicked.
What do you do? Ulti?
He ulted. He just blew his load.
Did they, like, did they see
they it? They definitely pinged it out. It was super obvious. I'm not sure if he tried to go for a Q play or if he just misclicked, but either way, it was just pointless. And I was just about to say, like, VP, the only way they can come back into the side is they hit, like, the super combo, and now they don't even have it anymore.
Illidan's dead. And I want to look at buybacks, actually. Illidan does have buyback, but not worth it for a tier 2 right here, right now, and especially not without your ultimate. Well, G is actually pushing down a bottom lane. He's got himself 2,500 gold, but he just reclaimed in a couple of minutes' time as exotic tier. Not really under any pressure at all. Supreme will get pushed back by the cold feet. A little bit annoying to handle that one. FNG stunned himself with that concoction. I don't know how they stop this.
Yeah, this is again where the Nightstalker pick sort of like pays off. I mentioned early on how his laning presence and like early to mid game presence is really weak in this lineup. But the fact that he was able to farm off with an Aghanim Scepter makes it so that he's insanely strong right now. He provides his team with so much map control. And it's almost impossible for VP to find an ult. Oh, never mind. Supreme is just like...
I'm going in. His ultimate pops and the Shackle Shot will catch Exotic Deer, but he's got the ultimate. He's got the Aegis even. So Shadow Fiend's not worried about this at all. You know, kill me. It's going to wear off in a couple of seconds. He's going to get the curse onto FNG. He's going to stun himself and Requiem Exotic Deer. Not even dead yet. Supreme gets forced back. He's not got Reincarnation anymore. This death could mean a lot, but he's still not finished off as that Glimmer Cape keeps him alive and gets him back to safety. Oh god, he's dead still. Nope, the Nightmare Deny. Nope, Cold Embrace. Oh my god, really?
Yeah, it's actually... This is disgusting.
That's insane. I mean, Poison Touch, Gale, everything's on him like he's dead. He's dead. He's... Okay, they saved him. They saved him.
And Lil's just shooting out an AA Blast. I think he expects him to be in... No, I don't even know what this is. What is this AA Blast?
That is like Mind Games level 3000 or something, where you think, okay, the Wraith King's going to TP, but he's not going to TP back to Fountain because he knows that I'm going to throw an Ice Blast. So he's going to TP up to the tier 3 and then wait for my Ice Blast. So I'm going to throw my Ice Blast there to counteract all of this nonsense coming out of him. But you know what? It just didn't happen. Yeah. G, he's looking.
Well, he can't find a solo kill here, for sure.
I don't know.
He has a gem.
I don't know if he can, because like you said, there's a gem on him, and there was Nisha behind. This Winter Wyvern with Force, Mech, Arcanes, and Glimmer.
The supports
are ridiculously farmed.
This Wyvern almost has as much farm as Illidan, who is a safe laner. I mean, Illidan, to be honest, his lane was really solid. I just don't think he applied enough pressure to the tower. And overall, after the laning stage, he incredibly fell off. We didn't really mention it too much, but he hasn't really done anything. He hasn't really farmed. He's died 4 times, and he's going to die 5th.
Well, Hookshot does come in, but already killed him off. There's nothing they can do here, really, as Lil Slash kills himself to that blade mail of clockwork. Lil TPs and succeeds. And G has become the split-pushing rat hero. He's just running around trying to control these lanes and keep them as far out as possibly can. But without your Poison Nova, without your Venomancer, can you hold your base? Sure enough, FNG is building an Aghanim Scepter, don't know who for. Ice Blast with Acid Spray. You know, they've got some good high ground offensive capability here, but Wraith King, he's a great high ground breaker. The fact he can literally just go and sit up on high ground and deal with the damage incoming onto him. I'm not sure. They're going to take the safe route anyway. Defend up at top, stop G from pulling all these shenanigans up there. And wait for next Roshan, obviously. That's going to be the big, that's going to be the kicker.
Yeah, makes sense. If you're ATN, you really don't want to risk it. The Venomancer is going to be back up soon, or like, it's going to be back up now. Clockwork as well. And even though the Nova is not up, just the AA Blast is really strong, just in general as well. I mean, just one misstep, technically, you could run into really, really disastrous fights. So I definitely respect ATN's decision here to just fall back and just farm up a few items, because with this lineup, you can take your time. You can take as much time as you want. Awesome.
I'm sorry, I'm looking down to bot lane, there were three heroes at bottom lane, controlling the creep wave so it didn't hit the tower, damaging the creeps, so that FNG could get the last hits.
Yeah.
Because he needs the Aghanim Scepter, he needs to give it to someone. But again, who do you give it to? The AA or the Venomancer?
I think you give it to the Venomancer. AA is not even level 11 yet, and level 1 AA blast with Aghanim Scepter is still a level 1 AA blast, right? I think the Venom ult is much more important in team fight, to be honest.
Well, he's got it. Venomancer got given the Aghanim Scepter, so he's got that upgrade now. Sasu, though, this Nightstalker with Ags and Gem has just been running rampant. He's got full vision of pretty much everyone. The VP can't even ward outside of their base. They've got no vision, they've got no knowledge of where ATN are, they can't really get out. Now, did we see when Roshan respawns? I didn't see the little timer pop up. I'm just going to watch over the Rosh pit. Come on, show me the money. Show me when you are. There we go, 1 minute.
1 minute.
So, relatively fast respawn time there. As Team Alternate, it's going to be theirs. But I think that if virtus.pro have any chance in this game, any chance at all, contesting Roshan has to be something they do. Fight in there where they can get, you know, the choke point gaming, they can get their ultis off onto multiple people, but more importantly, stop Team Alternate getting... Is it Aegis and Cheese now, or is it just... It's just the second one, right?
I think it's just the second one, yeah.
Okay. Well, Aegis on the Shadow Fiend regardless. That means that there are two heroes over on Team Alternate that can go and stand up on high ground. VP need to do everything in their power to stop this. So Rocket Flares have to keep scouting and controlling that. While G with the Daedalus, he's got a ton of single focus damage there. But he has to be wary. He doesn't have buyback. He's actually bought out for this. He's got no buyback, and in they come. G scouted. Sasu smoked up and blink, blink, blink. Nope. G Windrun. Try and get away. TP. Oh, nope. I think that could be game defining.
Oh, he doesn't have buyback.
He bought Daedalus. He fully bought Daedalus.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
I only checked his inventory like a minute ago and he didn't have it then and he had all the money. So it's like, yeah, cool. Okay. Even if he does that, he has buyback, you know? The question is, did ATN check his inventory? Because if they saw that, what they do is definitely pressure. And I'd argue they even push without the Aegis.
Well, you look at the tier 2 at top, there isn't one.
Yeah.
It's already dead. Come on, Shadow Fiend. Come on, you can do it! It's only got 71 health. Let's hit it a couple of times. That's all you need to do. Supreme? Oh, no. That's nasty. That's nasty! He's got illusions. The illusions just walking into the base. Yep, kill me off. Come on, see what you can do. Tier 3 going to get pushed up into here, and they've got two lanes going in as well. So Supreme can take out mid-creep wave as they blink in, actually. Beacony popped out by the Nightstalker and Illidan. Try and blink and Gale into this one. Try and get in there with your ultimate. A TP out. Sasu gets himself away, but actually pressuring into the tier 3 pretty heavily here. It's the force staff pushing Supreme back in, but no, what? FNG demolished, but suicides in the end of Supreme. His ultimate's going to pop. Or maybe not. Cold Embrace heals him back up, and okay, Illidan. G, Shackle Shot, Supreme, still not dead. Static Charge bounces back, but the Power Shot will finish him. Still waiting for this Illidan jump in. Level 2 ultimate. Poison Nova, it's time. It's time.
11 seconds for AL. They have to wait for
them. Oh no, but they can't wait. DK Phobos is already dead. Supreme, his ultimate is down. 45 seconds. Racks have gone. They've got to go in. They have to go in. Ice Blast is ready, gonna fly out as well. Phoenix Grip onto Illidan, and in comes Ice Blast, not doing too much, but the Shackle Shot's good. Focus Fire not there from G. And Supreme is healed up with a Glimmer Cape. He turns back to fight. And this looks like it might just be lights out for virtus.pro as G gonna get shredded by the Requiem Rays, and they've got no buybacks. Team Alternate, take a lane of Raxxon, gonna take game 2.
Yeah. This is... Again, I mean, we talked about this in a lot. Like, this is just VP not hitting the timing whatsoever. And quite frankly, it's also Team Alternate, though. Like, I don't want to take anything away from Team Alternate. Like, the supports were really, really good. Like, this Bane performance, really strong. Like, this is how you have to play a Bane, right? You have to be really aggressive early on because that is such a good hero to set up stuff, so... Yeah, they part ways 1-1.
Yeah.
Good performance from ATN.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like, Bane, his stat gain is great. You know, his scale's decently. He's got some good lockdown, but... Early on in the game, like you said, we've seen it time and time again, whether it be the level 1 Enfeeble strat going in with a Brain Sap to trade hits now is the way to go. But 1-1, virtus.pro trade wins with Team Alternate. So first game of the Stage 2 group phases, that's what we see. virtus.pro starting off with a complete stomp, and then Team Alternate. Looks like they got their draft and they outplayed a little bit there. But Series 2 coming up in a couple of minutes, guys. A VP against Scary Faces. I believe we start in about 20 minutes. No, we don't. That's a lie. We start in 50 minutes. We start at 9 p.m. CEST. Hopefully, we'll get that pulled a little bit earlier, but I believe we're going to be starting at the scheduled time. So 50 minutes, 5-0, about an hour, something along those lines. virtus.pro against Scary Faces. Thanks for joining us, guys. I'm Durka and Skim, my co-caster. You can check him out on Twitter at SkimGaming. I hope we can get this game a little bit faster. 50 minutes is a long time.
It really is.
A long time. But, you know, you've got to do these things. You've got to allow a little bit of leeway in case there's DDoS or, you know, internet issues or anything like that. Fortunately, this series had none of them. We had, like, what, 3 minutes of pause between two games? It was smooth. It was really, really smooth.
It really was.
I have to point something out. Are you still on the score screen?
No, I am actually not.
Now, remember what Lil did in the previous game?
Yeah, he bought chainmails.
Do you know who did it this game?
No.
Nisha.
Aww.
Nisha is following in the footsteps of Lil. Lil sold everything and kept the two mangoes, like you said. You know, ramping up for the end of the game with a couple of mangoes, but chainmails. Five of them for Nisha. And that's how it's going to end the game. But yeah, we'll be back, guys, in a short while, hopefully, with the second series, Scary Faces against virtus.pro. Go and get yourselves a drink, some dinner. Go and take a trip to McDonald's or something. I don't know how you spend your evenings, but yeah, we'll be back soon after a little break.